Mini Chapter 102, Amber's Mission in the El Segundo Refinery. Bidding Scorpio take his sweet time in acclimatizing to meat space, Jamie leaves him in the bedroom on Zeus Drive. Down in the hallway, he encounters the house's resident, the Platinum Raven. Upstairs, you will find a new fellow beast, he tells her. His name is Scorpio. Her pink noise whirs in a cautious and provisional joy. I'll see you at 7 this evening, down the hill at my place, he adds, opening the front door to leave. I was hoping to tell you to bring him along then, to join the five of you in going down into the west side. But no, he needs to stay here for the next day or two. He's still finding his feet in meat space. So if I sent him back through a screen this soon after his incarnation, I might disorient him altogether. I think you'll get on fine together. Soak up his darkness and infuse it with platinum. See you soon. At 7 o'clock, down the hill, Jamie welcomes Ashley and Herb into the house on Electra Drive and ushers them upstairs. Entering the study, they see the same five beasts they saw last night, standing or seated on various perches and surfaces around the room, observing the pair's arrival with a studied calm, all poised and silent in their respective flavors. Hey guys and gals, pipes Herb jauntily. Okay, let's get straight down to work here, Jamie interjects. There'll be plenty of time for chit-chat later and maybe a nice newsy catch-up, which I'm sure you'll all be looking forward to. But first, Amber's mission, Herb. Take us there, if you please. So, the three humans take their respective positions in front of the requisite keyboards and monitors. Settling into the central hot seat, as if assuming control of a spacecraft, Herb gets to work, firing out a protracted torrent of commands as precise as a surgeon's incisions. Multiple kinds of graphical user interface and text editor windows full of code flicker up in succession across all screens. Then the entire west side of LA unfurls across Jamie's outsize central monitor. Adjusting many parameters of its display, Herb revolves and expands this environment. Then he zooms in towards a huge industrial area within it, hurtling the viewpoint ever down until the flatly styled, retro-flavored allure of its individual structures and vegetation stands out crisp in the late light of evening. At last, at the appointed moment, Amber is summoned, steps forward, and clambers in through the monitor like a giant blonde spider. On the inland side of the fenced-in corridor of Vista Del Mar Boulevard in El Segundo is the edge of a thousand-acre refinery, looking west through the night to the nearby ocean. Beyond the chain-link fence, a bank of shrubs and palms rises to a line of pale green oil tanks, each a cylinder some 50 meters in diameter. Across the empty road, Amber's muscular body stands immobile in silhouette, looking away from the refinery across the grand expanse of a concrete field that's lined, like an industrial orchard, with tall metal forms whose crossbars and finials are strung with a complex vegetation of wires, coils, and insulator cones. To his right and beneath him, the great bulk of a power station rises on this strip of land, where yellow-white lights illuminate a jet of steam between giant chimneys, with the edge of the Pacific lapping at the beach just beyond. Amber glances up and sniffs, catching a scent of something burnt and mineral. Thick electric cables sizzle in the humid air above, slanting down across the road towards him from a pylon on the refinery bank, and splaying out to rest upon two frames built below him on the concrete field to his right and left. He turns and cuts across the deserted road. He is at the dim midpoint between two widely spaced street lamps, and the chain-link fence is not too much higher than head height, so it's the work of an agile minute for his athletic limbs to clamber over the refinery's limits and drop down onto the earth beside the pylon's base, where he springs back upright before vanishing into the shadowy shrubs. Among the rocks half buried at the crest of the bank, his shoe stumbles against the fossil of some small sea creature now on dry land since the ocean bed rose long ago, a little ammonite spiral rock whose blood was once the sea. He looks up and onward, and there just ahead of him is a high steel fence. He stakes out its length, finding the point most shadowed by foliage and most adjacent to branches. And with that giant blonde spider's metal strength of his, he powers himself up between fence and branches and over the top. From here on, the refinery is Amber's. Fizz lights and gas lights dot the dark shine of a building of black steel high up on his left. Keeping in the shadows, he stalks along the low-lit aisles in between rows of tanks on metal fields, stepping over rails and under pipes, a sensuous embodiment of Jamie's exploration of this brand new west side. The figure of a security guard in the distance stops and stares, down an alleyway of girders. The man calls out, blows a whistle, sets off at a run, coming closer. Amber ducks from view, jumps up to grab a girder, swings his weight around and upwards, and lands upon a walkway. The man passes underneath, glancing all around, but fails to look above him. Treading softly, Amber runs along this raised level for several hundred meters. He curves up around a chimney base, via a spiral stairway, then curves down again. In the middle distance ahead, he can see the refinery complex's northern edge. He climbs back down from the walkway, down a ladder to the ground, and sprints towards that boundary, and through a car park and a gate to the outside world. Glancing back up at those metal towers behind him, as he trots across the quiet of El Segundo Boulevard and turns into Arena Street, he hears the air horns of the refinery's alarm system strike up with a long blare and then a short one, four times in succession. Each of the five high flare stacks emits a roaring tongue of flame at the same time, licking and swaying sky high into the night before dying back down into a roil of ultramarine heat haze around a tiny pilot light. The first flare stack's flame is black and blue. The second's flame is mauve and platinum. The third's flame is brown and green. The fourth's flame is apricot and blue. And the fifth's flame is black currant and black. Hearing the bleep of an incoming text, he checks his mobile phone. It's Jamie, sending the coordinates of the server farm. Amber had almost forgotten why he is really here. Okay then, he's done with being a sensuous embodiment of his maker's unfocused explorations around this new West Side landscape. Jamie's heart was never quite in this refinery mission, despite his best intentions for it, as Amber now perceives. It is time to graduate into being a more bloodlessly precise weapon, thank you. It is time for his real mission. He zigzags on foot through the quiet streets of El Segundo, locates his car at Grand Avenue and Main Street, fires it up, cruises north to Imperial Highway, and hangs a left along the southern edge of LAX. Swinging right onto the desolate width of Pershing Drive, up the western fringe of the airport, he whistles a tune in quarter tones. Ahead on the left is that discreet side turning into Sandpiper Street, where Ashley pulled up in her car while he was tailing her. The security gates that blocked the turning then, which she must have had to unlock, now stand open. Amber turns through the gap in the median of Pershing, then into Sandpiper itself. Just beyond the top of the slope, invisible from the road down behind him, stands an anonymous, newly built structure no bigger than a garden shed, on an otherwise featureless stretch of ground. He gets out and locks his car. He approaches the structure and pushes at its door. Unlocked, the door swings inward, revealing a small empty lobby with no signage. He enters and looks around this blank space, where there is little other than a pair of lift doors, beside which is a single button bearing a downward pointing arrow.